Thank you. Thank you. So is the presentation is visible to you? Okay. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sujit, for your generous introduction. So all of the world, I think everyone from the world has heard about the recent mass uprising in Bangladesh that is has been named as July Massacre. So let's see how we experience as mental health professionals. So Bangladesh is a lower middle income country with 170 million populations. It is surrounded by India. We have shared borders with India in three sites, and rest site is Myanmar and Bay of Bengal. We got independence in the December 1971. Constitutionally, we are a democratic country. However, there are challenges with transition of power, and which once a party is in the power, it thinks that he will be power lifelong. And there are, as a consequence, there are army regimes, military regimes multiple times. There are rampant corruption, money laundering, and extreme muscle power within the ruling government parties. So what do we have as an existing mental health system? The prevalence of psychiatric disorder is 18.7%. That is revealed by our latest National Mental Health Survey. At the same time, we have more than 90% treatment gap. We have 0.2 psychiatrists per 100,000 population, 0.4 psychiatric nurses, 0.3 psychologists. And considering the prevalence and the psychiatrist ratio, we have one psychiatrist for 100,000 patients, roughly. So there are four players in mental health services. Predominantly, it is ruled by the government services and private organizations. There are minor contributions from NGOs and the donor agencies. Now, no, it should be NGOs are playing a major role and donor agencies playing minor role, I would say. So the service is rendered in three levels, that is primary care level constituted by Upazila Health Complex. Under the Upazila Health Complex, there are two subdivisions, Union Subcenters and Community Clinics. Then it goes to the secondary care level constituted with the district hospitals, and further it goes to the tertiary care level with specialized hospitals and institutions and medical college hospitals. It is interesting to note that the psychiatrists are only placed and posted in tertiary care level hospitals. So there is no psychiatrist and mental health professional posted in primary and secondary care level. So if you see the referral pattern and health seeking behavior in Bangladesh, you see that there is no defined epidemiological catchment area, and people can visit any care level at any time if she can avail the physicians with the chamber fees. So at the government level, there are primary, secondary, and tertiary care level. There are other service providers like non-medical healers, traditional and religious healers, Ojha, Kobiraj, and at the same time, there are private chamber, hospital, and NGOs. So people can visit anytime at any care level without any hesitation. What are the enduring challenges in our country? It is, I previously mentioned that the treatment gap is more than 90%. There is unregulated help seeking pattern and no functional referral system, and there is no epidemiological catchment area. Our budgetary allocation is less than 5% of total health budget in mental health. There is only 10 Bangladesh taka for mental health in a year that is allocated in budget for an individual person. And there is inadequate psychiatrists and mental health professionals with inequitable distributions. Most of the psychiatrists and mental health professionals are available at city level, and mostly related to the capital city. The studies indicated that there is a huge out-of-pocket expense. It is more than 70% or there lack of studies on this issue, but the studies indicate that it should be more than 70%. There is poor mental health literacy, high stigma. As a country, as it has lower and middle income status, there is huge income disparity. And also, there are non-judicious prescribing, enormous polypharmacy that raises the high stigma that psychiatrists only prescribe the sleeping pills. There are some additional challenges, like the additional political challenge, I'd say. In the last 15 years, there was no meaningful national election. People can't vote their leaders. There are extrajudicial killing. There are political oppression. There are media censorship. And there are rampant corruption, money laundering, and extreme muscle power. So reports are coming out mentioning the extrajudicial killings. It is one of the famous report published in international media. They found that in the last 13 years, around 200 and 2,600 people were killed by extrajudicial executions, fatal shooting, and custodial torture. There are new names coming in Bangladesh. That is, in Bangla, it's Aynaghar, and in English, it's the secret prison and the room without any light, house of mirrors. So, in these houses, people are being held up for more than 8 hours, 10 hours, 9 hours, and they are coming out from this house. Then one report indicated that since 2007, there are 629 forced disappearances. Among these 629, the dead bodies were found 78, and 59 persons were released from this Aynaghar, and 73 were channeled to the custodial system by showing arrest. And there was no trace of 419 persons. But many persons believe that the number are underestimated. The number could be raised and it could be high, near to 1,000. There are freedom of expressions. There are extreme lack of freedom of expression. There is a black law called Digital Security Act. And it has been cited in international human rights organizations like Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International, indicating the oppression and the arrested by force of Digital Security Act. So these include the journalists, even the students and adolescents. So what happened in this recent movement? There is the movement started with the anti-quota protest. So quota is basically reservation for a specific group to ensure the overall representation in various community, ethnic group, religious minority, and gender or gender minority, or the other physically challenged persons. So it was introduced in 1972. By contemporary government, that there should have some reservation for the persons who fought for the country in 1971 Liberation War. So since 1972, it was prevailed that in first class and second class jobs, there will have only 44% of the jobs will be based on merit, and rest of the 56% reserved for the specific groups, and among them 30% will be for the descendants of freedom fighters, and rest 10% for women, 10% for underdeveloped districts, 5% for ethnic minorities, and 1% for physically challenged persons. So there are critics regarding this quota system over the time, and it was abolished in 2018 after a huge protest, countrywide huge protest. And the current anti-quota movement was focusing on the 30% quota for the descendants of freedom fighters. So that creates a challenge for the government as it goes to, as is related to the freedom fighters. So as I discussed that the, in government jobs only in first and second class job, only 40% of the jobs will be based on merit, and rest 56% will be based on the quotas. So this movement started in early July once the government re-invoked the decision again that the removal of quota will be revived, and there should have 30% quota for freedom descendants of freedom fighters. But initially the movement was peaceful, and in July 15 it was it became violent. The ruling party thugs and even the police attacked the peaceful students with rods, sticks, and firearms like revolver. Then suddenly the movement became violent, and this is the symbol of protest. I think the photo has been circulated across the world thousands of times. It has been seen, observed. This is Abu Said, who was killed by the police by firing. So he died on 16 July, and the movement spread out all over the country. So to refrain the movement, the ruling government was trying to control by implying unnecessary force. They ordered police to fire to the students and peacefully protesting community peoples. By this time, the community people involved in the movement, the social media has been crowded with painful videos, and the firing was done from the helicopters, and curfew was imposed, and paramilitary and military forces were deployed, movements were restricted. At the same time, block raids were made to find out the students and to arrest them from their home in front of their parents. And the mobile internet services are disconnected, and also the broadband services, internet was disconnected. And sometimes it was connected and sometimes disconnected. Most of the time, the Facebook, WhatsApp, Messenger, and Telegram was disconnected. So this is the scenario. People came to the street against the government and protesting the anti-quota movement. And this figure, when the people captured the Ganabhavan, the house of Prime Minister. So what happened in this movement is thousands of people are injured, hospitals are overcrowded, more than 10,000 people are arrested by crackdown, block raids, and by the law enforcement agency. And there are about 300 cases among them. There are 4,50,000 unnamed persons who are accused. So this is the 36th July, the victory day. It was on 5th August, the Prime Minister fled to India. So what damage done by this movement? The, as different reports mentioning the different statistics, as per the Human Rights Support Society, they identified the 819 persons died, including police officers, journalists, children, and the young kids, as 4 years old. But the other reports indicate that the death count crosses more than 1,500. There are wounded more than 20,000. And the loss of extremity and cripples around 600. So the reports available till September 10, there are eye injuries about more than 850. There are hospitalization related to eye injury is 718. There are bullet injuries in eye, that is 685, and more than 500 eye operations. There are bilateral blindness around 100 and single eye blindness around 400. So these 89 children and adolescents who had died, it was calculated based on the 823 deaths. There are bullet injuries in about 80 children, and 9 died by burn. And interestingly, the children with 4 years of age died by firing from a helicopter. So these are the different estimates in different reports. At least we have noticed that around 1581 persons died. As per the estimates of the students, there are injuries near more than 33,000, and the other eye injuries also. So what happened during the event? There was curfew, there was internet shutdown, there was process on the streets, and government imposed the holidays. So that disconnected the whole service, any sort of mental health services. That is, the hospitals are only emergency services are available, and that is in limited service. The telepsychiatry and telemental health and telemedicine was closed due to the internet disconnection, and there was curfew, and there was movement restrictions. Even the ambulances were broken by the students or the persons participating in the protest. So at that time, there are acute fear, intimidation, and there are fear of arrest. There was communication blackouts, arresting of family members, political oppression, fear of politically motivated violence, and certainly there is the concerns of human rights violations. So due to the curfew, the internet was shut down, regular services as well as telepsychiatric services was unavailable. So during the event, there developed mistrust, because anybody can attack the any persons. At that time, anybody can be arrested based on his social media activities, as the nation was divided grossly in two sections. One is the favor with the government, and the other is in favor of the movement. So there was mistrust, perceived threat, loss of social integrity, and it develops mob psychology. The situations deteriorates once there are risk of exposure to abuse, isolation, victimization, and witnessing the life-threatening situations of killing the colleagues and friends. That certainly raised the concerns of development of psychiatric disorders. And also there is mass violence, rampant fire, experience of killing of friends could potentiate the multiple psychiatric morbidities like acute stress disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, anxiety, panic disorder, substance use, and sleep disorders. So after the event, there are concerns of developing newly developed psychiatric disorders. There are violence, the consequences of violence, and changes in social status. It happens the persons with pro-governmental or the supporting regimes, they are enjoying better benefits from the government. And after changing the government, just within a second, everything changed. So that creates lots of psychological pressure in both group of people. So there are relationship issues with the regarding the protest. The many new relationships formed, those who are in the same group, and new friendships. The friendships are broken based on the their opinion supporting the protest or against the protest. There are anticipatory fear because the the mob or attacking the persons, those who are supported the left government. So we have experienced that though the studies are yet to come out, but practically we have seen that patients from psychosis, bipolar disorder, and acute stress reaction, sleep disturbance in our private chamber, that is absolutely related with the protest. And there are also re-emergence of previous psychiatric disorders. Those who are well with previous medications, they are new episodes of depression, anxiety, and obsessive compulsive disorders. There are concerns of substance use disorder, and we are getting patients that the intensity of substance abuse has been increased. So these protests is the somewhat a example how political milieu affects our mental health in and the overall social variables of mental health in the community. It is quite challenging that these mass uprisings happens very sporadically and irregularly. So it is quite challenging how international agencies could raise voice to restore the social integrity and peace. And also the local, regional, and international bodies can have eyes considering the learnings from this mass uprising in the other settings. And after the event, local and local national leaders, religious and educational celebrities should attempt to restore the peace and avoid hate comments in social media to reduce the social chaos.